say you're interested in neuroscience and you visit your local university, and what you're typically going to see is a room that looks like this. You're going to see big equipment. It looks very intimidating. It looks very hard to use, and it's also very expensive. My parents were teachers, my grandparents were teachers, my aunt and uncles were teachers in colegios, and while I was studying for my graduate degree, I would always visit colegios once or twice a month to teach neuroscience. But it really bothered me that I had to bring dead brains from the medical school or invent these little demos with Nerf balls. I'm an electrophysiologist. I study the electricity that the brain generates in order to understand how the brain functions. So it bothered me that I could not actually bring this equipment into a colegio because it's big, it's not portable, and it's very hard to use in kind of a classroom environment. And for me, this is kind of a tragedy because 1 in 5 people in this world will be affected by a neuroscience disease at some point in their life. And so there's probably some people in this room that have a loved one that's afflicted with a brain disorder. And have you taken your loved one to the doctor and your loved one comes back, oh, you know those memory problems I've been having. It turns out I have early onset Alzheimer's, but we have some prescriptions and I have some memory regimens. And over the next 2 or 3 months, todo está bien. I mean, I wish that exists, but for almost every single brain disease that we know of, there are not cures. And one reason is that the barrier to entry is very high. And another reason is that the brain is just very complicated. It's an electrochemical organ. In the fields of space science or physics or computer science or electrical engineering, you can start as early as you want to. You can go to Walmart, which is a store in the United States, and buy a $10 telescope and start looking at the moon. Sure, it won't be a very good telescope, but it'll get you started. And in physics and electrical engineering and computer science, we're seeing every day with things like the Arduino and others that we are lowering the barrier to entry to some fields, but it's just not happening for life sciences. And we all know what this invention is. It's the first consumer-grade computer. Now, you could buy a computer in the 70s, but you would be a professor at, say, Universidad de Buenos Aires. You'd write the big grant for $40,000 or $50,000. If you're lucky and talented, perhaps you'd get the grant, and then you'd get that computer. And neuroscience is similar today for very high-end equipment. But once you actually lower the cost and you lower the barrier to entry, you advance your field. And the revolutions we are seeing today in computers are precisely because the product became consumerized. And so when I was finishing my doctorate degree, I had a good friend and colleague, Gregory Gage, and we self-funded this project we called the $100 spike. A spike is what we neuroscientists call an action potential, which is the pulse that neurons use to communicate. And so look at our high production values. It's very similar to the TED production values today. You can see all this very fancy wood. And nothing really worked at this demo we gave 3 to 4 years ago, but educators were so excited, they encouraged us to keep pushing this project of making low-cost neuroscience available to teachers and professors around the world. And so this is our first invention. Se llama el Spikerbox. We call it the Spikerbox, and it's simply a single-channel amplifier that can amplify the very small electrical impulses that are generated by neurons. And we use insects as models because they're easy to bring into the classroom. And we've also developed mobile software so that kids can plug in their phones and record the electrical impulses. A kid told me that he wanted it on his phone. I wasn't clever enough to think that myself. So a little bit of theory, your neurons are very special. I'm talking fast, you guys are thinking fast, I'm not moving very fast, I'm just standing here. But the reason your brain is fast is because it has these long processes called axons that fire pulses of electricity we call spikes. And they travel very far from your brain to your spinal cord to your toes. And this is a delicate dance of ion channels that move potassium and sodium across the neural membrane. So we're going to try to do an experiment in vivo aquí. So we use cucarachas de Bolivia and Peru. Cockroaches have very large neurons in their legs that generate very large electric fields that are quite easy to record. And also, if you cut the leg off a cockroach when it's a hoven, when it's young, the leg will grow back. So we're constantly searching the animal kingdom for very simple and humane ways to demonstrate neuroscience, and the cockroach is the best. And earlier this morning, I put a cockroach in ice water to anesthetize it. I cut off one of its legs. Cucaracha está bien. He can still walk with five legs. So Disculpame, perdón for the cockroach. So let's try to get this working. So right here is the invention. You can see it's called the Spikerbox, and I have a cockroach leg hooked up to it. So I'm going to turn it on, and we'll see if it works. We'll see if we get some nice signal. So let's plug it in to the little speaker to make it a little bit louder. All right, it sounds like static, but if I touch the barbs on the leg, we should hear a discharge of action potentials. Escucha? Palomitos de maíz. It sounds like popcorn, but we can also look at it. So let me hook it up to my iPad here, and we should be able to see the action potentials as well. So un momento. All right. So when I touch the leg, we should see the pulsos. Okay. So there you go. That's actually happening in your brain right now, right now, right now, right now, and right now. There are 100 billion neurons in your brain firing these pulses of electricity, and through a mystery that scientists, Argentinian, are studying. I'll turn it back on. Should we hear it again?
Yeah, please.
Okay, sure. I'll always demonstrate more spikes. Okay. Ruido.
Ruido.
All right. That's feedback, so... all right, that was real. Did you all hear that? Okay, so through a mystery that... trying to figure out how all the neurons in your brain communicate with each other to generate cognition and behavior. So this is a simple model that allows us to start investigating neurons. I wasn't able to see this until I was in late undergrad, and I wanted to be a neuroscientist. We could also, this technology is approximately 90 years old with recording action potentials, but there's a technology of talking to muscles and neurons, which is 250 years old, by an Italian scientist called Luigi Galvani. And he discovered by accident that if you stimulate the nerves of a leg of a frog, the leg would twitch. And so we can do that in the cockroach leg as well. So I don't have a big battery and big equipment, but I also have this technology in my pocket that will allow us to stimulate the neurons quite easily. So it's called, does anybody know what this is? I didn't invent this, I wish I did. It's the iPod Nano, and it's capable of generating enough voltage to excite the neurons in la pata de la cucaracha. So let's give this a shot. All right, so I'll hook it up to this leg right here. Bienvenidos a mi laboratorio. Yeah. Okay, so. So I'm going to play some music, and if we're lucky, it should work. So let's give it a shot. So this leg right here. Sí, la cucaracha de pata se mueve. So, yeah. Yeah. All right, the cockroach doesn't like hip hop. We haven't made a discovery here. But the hip-hop has bajas frecuencias, low frequencies, and low frequencies of music are around 20 to 200 hertz. And those pulses we saw in the cockroach leg before are, you know, fire at the same kind of frequency from approximately 1 to 200 times a second. So the frequencies of hip-hop music are similar to the frequencies that the neurons use. If we use classical music, classical Argentinian music, which is beautiful, it would not work because it's composed of higher frequencies. Now, I just showed you two technologies, recording and stimulation. So you could imagine that you could combine these things. So if I were recording from your brain and you had the unfortunate accident of actually breaking your spinal cord, perhaps we could record from your brain and then stimulate your spinal cord, your muscles, and I have a lot of colleagues actually working on this. So this technology we also showed with the pata de cucaracha also works with a squid. And so I did some experiments at the Marine Biological Laboratory in Woods Hole with my colleague Greg Gage, and I'm talking to you, I'm speaking to you, and that's how I'm communicating with you in English. Lo siento, cada día estoy practicando, leyendo Condorito, cada día. But a calimar, a squid, communicates by changing the color of his skin. So I'll try to show this to you. So this is a calimar of Massachusetts. It's not from Chile, which are the ones that are very big. So so this is the same experiment where we're stimulating it with music. And so you can see how rapidly it's changing. We have a YouTube video that reached 2 million views in 1 week where you were actually looking under a microscope, and it's quite beautiful. Okay, so for now, let's stop with the cockroaches. So the cockroach has a brain, it has neurons that fire action potentials, but you and I fire action potentials as well. And it's not only your neurons, muscles can too. So when I think of moving my hand, I generate a command in my brain. It travels from an upper motor neuron to my spinal cord, and then that synapses with a lower motor neuron that reaches a muscle. And when that lower motor neuron reaches the muscle, it fires neurotransmitters called acetylcholine, which is a very famous neurotransmitter because poisonous creatures mess with that system for obvious reasons. And so when the acetylcholine binds to the muscle then fires an action potential. And when muscle fires an action potential, muscles are very special cells, like neurons. But muscles change shape when they fire action potentials, and that's why, you know, we can move our arms. So we have a brand new invention. We just finished this last week. So primero demostración pública está aquí. So let's give it a shot. So this is a little bit different. It's called the human Spikerbox. Now let's see if we can hear it. So I'm gonna try to put an electrode on my muscles, and when I contract, we should hear some activity. So one moment. Because we're gonna try to record from my muscle, we're not directly in the tissue like we were with the cockroach, so we have to use conductive gel. Probably some of you who've had your heart monitored have noticed these patches. So this is just a little bit of gel I'm going to put on these electrodes, and hopefully it'll work. Es una nueva invención. All right, so. All right, so you hear something. All right, so the more I contract, the more action potentials are being elicited in the muscles. So, and if I think really hard and I just slightly move, I can actually generate a single twitch or a single action potential. We have this new invention we call the RoboRoach. And I know a lot of you, maybe you're at Thanksgiving or whatever the equivalent is in Argentina, and your grandma's like, why haven't they cured Alzheimer's? Why haven't they cured cancer? Why haven't they given us cyborg cockroaches? You can be like, wait, hold on now. Give the scientists credit. I think they're working on that last one. So can we switch to the monitors, please? So what we have here is our cyborg cockroach. So nuestra misión es Neurociencia para todos, It's also mochilas para todos. So we have a little backpack we put on the cockroach, and we've put small electrodes in the antenna, and the cockroach, when it's moving, and if its antenna hit a wall, it'll turn and run in the opposite, and run along that wall. So we're trying to trick the cockroach. So we've had prototypes of this for the past couple of years. You notice it gets smaller and smaller and smaller. But this is analog electronics. It's only stimulating at one frequency, 55, 55 hertz. And to be a really useful scientific instrument, you want to really control the stimulation paradigms. But it does work. I did a demo at a colegio in Santiago, and you can see it right here. So there are some students playing with the cyborg cockroach. So obviously, any student who sees that is going to be really curious about how it's actually working. So it's a nice demo to explain how you design electronics, how neurons work, how behavior works. But I'm a bad engineer. And I live in Chile now through a start from, I tengo un beca de Corfo. I have a fellowship from Corfo through the Startup Chile program. And I wanted to sponsor some student engineers to help me design, Greg and me design a better Roboroach, a digital Roboroach. So these are the students, Alejandro, Rimsky, and Yanko. And Rimsky and Yanko are actually in the audience right now. They're down here. And so if you have really technical questions, you ask them, because I don't know how they did it. It's increíble, see? This is the first prototype. We have one right here. This is also, so Rimsky and Yanko are sweating because it should work, right? C'est fonctionnel? Yeah, c'est fonctionnel, okay. So we have a giant cockroach here, and we're gonna try to do this. So hold on a sec. All right, so this primero prototipo. So instead of being controlled by a remote control, we're using an iPad or an iPhone now. So this was, I also didn't code this, the students did. They should be the ones up here, not me. So it's all in Spanish, which I like. So now I'm going to put the battery in the cockroach, and let's see if we can connect. All right. Whoa. Se mueve. All right. All right, we're connected. We're connected, Yanko. Connected Rimsky. All right, so we can give this a shot. So let me kick this guy up. All right. So it's un grande cucaracha. All right. Este Bolivia. Whoa. Whoa. Congratulations. Se funciona. I didn't think that would work. So, all right, so the cockroach is fine. I'm going to take the backpack off after the see, they also have a nice behavior right here. So, but he's too big to fly, so he doesn't fly. So in conclusion, the only limit to scientific discovery should be your creativity and your hard work. It shouldn't be the access to your equipment. So we've been continually working hard to make equipment as accessible as possible so that niños y estudiantes en todo el mundo can study the brain if they like. And we're in all six continents, and we're pretty close to Antarctica, so maybe we'll get there too with more work. So muchas gracias.